first of all the CEO of the World Federation of Advertisers, Stefan Lörke. The European Privacy Officer at Axiom, Dr. Sachiko Shoying. And the Senior Director, Deputy Commercial and Privacy at AppNexus, Julia Schulman. And obviously we have a moderator for you because I am not going to moderate this panel. So the moderator is coming up on stage. She's a professional. She's done it for years. And she's coming out already. I told you to wait backstage. Oh. Whatever. Come on. Come in. You're very much appreciated. Townsend Fian. Yeah. This is normal. You always have people that are so eager to come on stage. Yeah. Townsend, I know you. You're brilliant in your business. So, first of all, we need your interaction. Please grab the remote controls underneath your seats because we have a voting tool question, first of all, for you. So, nehmen Sie bitte Ihre Fernbedienung unter den Sitzen hervor. And you see the question here for you. Is your company prepared and sufficiently informed about the impact of the GDPR? The General Data Protection Regulation, as said before. Number one, yes. Number two, no. Number three, not sure. So what is going to be the answer? That's what I want to hear from you. Tony, tell me, what do you think? What's going to win?
Yes, we're all over it.
Stefan?
I'd say no.
Sachiko?
Oh yeah, we are. We have to.
We have to? Julia?
Yeah, absolutely.
Well, we have to, I would agree. The question is, where are they, to be honest? I've seen various companies that have no clue about GDPR. They didn't even know what it is, to be honest. So,
look at that.
And you see, the question is no. The answer is no on the question. So, Tony, this is your starting point to moderate the panel. Good luck. Give them a hand again. Come on.
Thanks very much. Martin, nowhere to go but up since I mess up the simple instruction of arriving on time. So this panel is intended to be a little bit of knowledge sharing and a little bit of mobilization. There's a little call to arms at the end. But first we're going to do the knowledge sharing. So you got the names of the panelists from Martin. But I'll just give you two more sentences about each of my colleagues. Stefan Lörke has been the managing director of the World Federation of Advertisers since November 2003. He is the co-founder and a steering committee member of the Advertising Education Forum. And prior to joining WFA, Stefan worked for L'Oréal in Paris and Brussels. Julia Schulman is senior director, deputy general counsel, commercial and privacy at AppNexus, leading AppNexus's global privacy work. So she's really in the hot seat as her company gets ready for May of next year. And Sachiko Shoyong is the European Privacy Officer for Axiom and a global leader. Axiom is a global leader in marketing services, and she is chairwoman of the Federation of the European Direct and Interactive Marketing Association. So these are three great sources of learning and information about the challenge that is coming in the run-up to May of next year. When you leave, we hope that you have a little bit more of an idea of what this General Data Protection Regulation is, why it really is business critical and not just an arcane technical regulatory topic. You have some idea of what you can do to help prepare your company, what the timing is, and what might be some positive consequences of it, because it's not all bad news, actually. And then there will be the call to arms, the recruitment pitch. So Sachiko, do you want to start giving us an idea of what the GDPR is and what changes in comparison, because it's not that we didn't have any rules at all before next May in the area of privacy and data protection?
Sure, Tony. I'm so grateful that you also highlighted the point that this is not only all bad news. GDPR originally was thought as part of this legal package called the Digital Single Market. And this Digital Single Market legal package was there to actually grow and enable the digital economy in Europe to prosper, right? And they thought, right, we need to have one privacy law because as it is right now, it doesn't make any sense. And that indeed is one big change that we're going to have in Europe. GDPR brings one law all over Europe. I think you've heard a lot of like negative things that I'm sure, but I'll just quickly touch on them anyways. First of all, your penalty, the maximum penalty is 4% of your global annual revenue. Now, this sounds not very trivial, but if you think about it, say you're in an agency and you're only making a margin of 10 or 15% out of whatever humongous revenue that you're making. Well, you know, they're not taking a look at your profitability. They're taking a look at your global revenue. So that's like, ouch.
Right? Real penalties with teeth for breaches.
Yes. Yeah. And then also, I think this is also the reason why many colleagues of mine, many privacy colleagues of mine from all over the world, not only in Europe, are coming, are getting really concerned because it actually expands the applicability of the law. Yeah. Like compared to the current situation, the moment you are actually providing services or goods to European citizen, then law applies. For instance, if you do tracking, interest-based marketing is usually considered as tracking, then it would apply to you too. Now let me talk about the good thing about it. From my point of view, I think GDPR is a great success. Because in one thing, I mean, yeah, Tony, you're looking like, you know, how do you see that? But the one thing is, it really, you know, accountability principle is something that I have been personally involved in already for many, many years. There are think tanks that are really intensively thinking about this effort. You are talking about the obsolescence of opt-in. People back in that time acknowledged that opt-in is not working. Well, for me, it is really, really annoying. But not only that, for actually, if you think about the fairness of the law, what you're doing is you're making the consumers accountable, the users accountable and responsible because they have ticked the box. Yeah. You are shoving the responsibility. And therefore, without improving any privacy, you are actually doing nothing else but putting the responsibility to the wrong side. And so GDPR put that in the right context. I really welcome that. Because they said, in exchange, what we'll do is we'll give you this thing called legitimate interest, which is a bit more broadened. It comes with responsibility, of course. You need to document your many things. You need to provide transparencies. If you're using this thing called legitimate interest as a legal basis, okay, you don't need an opt-in, but A, you need to balance the interest. So on the one hand side, you have a legitimate interest. Let's take a look. Let's put your feet in the shoes of the users, the consumers. Is this fair to them? You know, so you weigh up the balance. If you get that, one tick. The second point is you need to actually do it in a way so that it meets the expectation, the reasonable expectation of the users. How do you do that? Well, lawyers say, well, put it up on the privacy statement. So here you go, tick two. If you've done that, you only have one more thing to do. And the third point is to provide an opt-out link. Now, I think this is a tremendous improvement from this opt-out regime. So that's one thing. Tanya, I don't want to take too much time, so I just say one more thing about the things that GDPR brings that are really, really good. It's combined with the definition of personal data.
Yeah.
As you mentioned, you know, before it was some sort of unclarity, but they clearly said online identifiers, location data, they are all personal data. Now, that may be the bad news. The good news is, however, they now have this definition called pseudonymous data. Pseudonymous data is processing of a personal data, and I couldn't remember, so I wrote it down, in such a manner that personal data can no longer be attributed to specific data subject without use of additional information. Well, that's cookie. Well, that's Mac ID. That's device ID.
Yeah.
That's all right. And pseudonymous data provides you some sort of an exemptions like subject access request and so on, you don't have to deal it as rigorously as other plain personal data. So I'll keep my comment to this level and pass it back to you, Tony.
Okay. So there is, you know, in this new legal framework that will apply from next year, you have arguably more data covered, you have narrower legal bases to process it, you have these really scary sounding fines. What is AppNexus doing to get ready for this and maybe even, you know, turn it to some sort of competitive advantage? I mean, how's that playing out also from a business perspective?
Yeah, thanks. It's a great question. So we are, as Sakiko was saying, there are a lot of changes. And so we are taking a very conservative approach.
Yeah.
You know, this is not a law that dropped out of the sky and forced a whole number of new requirements on us. It's been in effect for over 20 years, and it's really just an update to an existing law. And I think there are a lot of people out there that don't really recognize that. So we get a lot of questions from people who do realize that, and they say, well, why are you saying you're making so many changes when there was already this law in place that everyone was supposed to be complying with? You know, and our answer to that is we have been complying with that as we've interpreted that over the years. But some of the major updates to this new regulation that are coming through, like Sakiko just said, are clarifications around the definition of personal data and certain things like data subject access requests, where individuals will get access to the data that we all hold on them, and additional major requirements around records and being able to better explain to individuals what we're doing with their data. I think the other thing to keep in mind is that, you know, this law is a principles-based regulation. And you're supposed to take a risk-based approach to how you use that data. And so over the years, we've all had different interpretations on what those principles required and how much of a risk came out of processing all of that data. But with all of the fines that could come out of this new regulation, I think everyone is asking their partners to take a closer look at what they're doing and take a more conservative view of what they're doing. And that is what we're doing because we believe it is better for the market, and we do believe that our clients need that and we need to take that approach. So specifically with respect to certain issues, I think consent is a big issue. And we'll go into that a little bit more on how that plays out under GDPR and e-privacy. But right now, we can't stick our heads in the sand and not have any sort of solution for the potential most conservative outcome around consent. We need to be ready for that. So we are going to be ready for that. We also need to be ready to handle the most conservative views on other issues. Like, if we cannot obtain consent, how do we still continue to provide services to our clients? How do we handle data subject access requests? And how do we handle providing our services when our clients and others in market actually don't completely agree on who is a controller and who is a processor? And for this group to understand that classification under the regulation actually dictates the different obligations on different companies. And when the market itself can't actually agree on which companies fall within those classifications, we as a company at AppNexus need to be ready to fulfill all of those obligations across all of our services and products. So those are some of the big things that, you know, we've gone all in on, and we believe this is really important, not just for ourselves, but for our clients and for the individuals out there whose data we are actually collecting and using.
Can I ask, so you guys are a global company, but originally US-based. Can you explain how, as you put everything in place to be able to abide by the European law, how does that affect what you do in the US? Does it have any, you try to like keep a Chinese wall, any kind of wall between the more prescriptive and, you know, arguably more onerous requirements in Europe and what you, your conduct on the US market or other global markets?
Yeah, it is a challenge. Stefan and I were just discussing this. You know, I think there are a lot of requirements under this regulation. The question about consent is just one issue. So when it comes to just our privacy program behind the scenes in terms of our documentation and our privacy by design and privacy impact processes, you know, those are processes that we have always had across the globe. We don't take a different approach. But when it comes to things like legal basis of processing, i.e., do we need consent? You know, we're going to build to that, and I think we're all going to, as a market, have to see whether that ends up being ruled out globally or whether it, you know, it is just within the European market. It's definitely a challenge that we're all struggling with.
I think the Brussels regulators do like to see themselves as the regulators for the world, and it's interesting this sort of the degree to which we can become an accessory to that if we aren't careful. And
it's a good question. I mean, and we are very involved on the U.S. self-regulatory side, and so that is a question that folks are still actively discussing in market. We've had a very, very long history of, you know, regulating ourselves.
Stefan, how does it look from the advertiser perspective? Are advertisers, are they looking at us as somebody else's problem mostly, or what's the mood?
They certainly don't look at it as someone else's problem. They see it very much as a challenge for them as a brand. I'd like to say as an intro that I find actually the audience here remarkably candid and honest in their response, that actually 25% of them feel they're prepared. Because I think that reflects to some extent the reality of the business. We're talking here about a piece of legislation. Usually in a company, you would delegate that to your lawyers, no? They deal with that. The challenge with the GDPR is no lawyer is ever going to solve it for you. It's going to be requiring collaboration of marketers and lawyers to make sure that you translate that piece of legislation into a way of gathering consent which makes sense for consumers. Okay? So it's not about telling a lawyer, no, give me a consent piece which is going to tick all the boxes, I'm safe. Yeah. It's about working with a lawyer in order to devise a way to interface with consumers which is going to be delivering consent which meets those new requirements. And that is the challenge of the whole exercise. Mm-hmm. Now, I'm going to talk about our members, and our members tend to be, you know, big global brands, you know, companies like Mercedes, Red Bull, Adidas, Nestle. You know, they, if anything, they are the companies which have, you know, lots of resources in place and which have the sort of frameworks to deal with these sort of challenges. But actually, when we ask them where they stand and where the challenges are, you realize how much work there still needs to happen for companies to be comfortable. So we have 60%, so 60%, of our members who tell us this stuff is critically important to our business, okay? That's brand owners, clients saying that. It's not ad tech companies, it's brand owners, okay? And when we ask them what's the major risk in this? And interestingly, the major risk perceived by brand owners is not the fines, okay? The fines make the headlines of the newspapers, but it's not that what is perceived as the main risk. The main risk is the brand reputation. Yeah. What happens if we get it wrong in terms of consumer trust and perception? That's the number one risk. Actually, number five is the fines, interestingly. Although the fines can be very large, as you said. Yeah. But I think it's important to keep that in context. And so when we asked our members, how well they feel their marketeers are prepared for GDPR, they told us almost the same percentage as here. 70% felt that marketers were not sufficiently aware. And that's 8 months before it comes into force. And additionally, to your point also, there's still a majority of people who feel this is a European piece of legislation. Okay, so it's going to be impacting our business in Europe, but for the rest, no, we're going to be fine. Whereas there's a big nuance. This piece of legislation applies to EU citizen data wherever that data is processed. And chances are that companies in Silicon Valley or in Shanghai are processing some kind of EU citizens' data. So there's very significant global implications of a European piece of legislation. I think another thing which might be of interest to the discussion here is when you ask brands, what are the main challenges in implementing this stuff? Where are the obstacles? The number one concern is, how do we get consent going forward? No. This is ultimately about redefining the terms of exchange with consumers, no? We've lived in easy times, no? That's what we'll say in May 2018. Because going forward, we will have to explain in detail why people should be sharing their data and what's the motivation for that. So we move into an age where we need to be thinking in terms of value exchange. What is it in this for consumers for them to be accepting to share their data? Oh, is that
okay? So there's a question. This is exciting.
The question is coming from here. Just turn around, Tony. I just wanted to show the audience that you can use the buzzer. But I really have a question. I really have a question for you. You were talking about fines. I wonder how far the EU can go in terms of fining a company or kind of harming a company's brand when they are kind of challenging them in terms of data. I can imagine that many companies are not really following the GDPR in the future. So what would be your advice and how far can GDPR go in terms of the EU?
Well, so I think there's like a black and white answer what's in the law. I think it's like 4% of global turnover or 20 million euros, whichever is bigger. I think one of the fears that we have is that the enforcement's probably going to be arbitrary, that this new regulation, which brings a lot of new requirements on companies, doesn't mean that the enforcement apparatus, that the agencies that are charged with making sure that companies obey the law get, 100 times more employees. And so I think we think that as they don't have more staff to deal fairly, they're going to do kind of symbolic, they're going to bring symbolic cases, and some of the enforcement, as I say, may be arbitrary and a little bit unfair. And I think that's a really difficult area, but it's a sort of political area that we're not getting into yet, pending the moment when the thing is actually in force and meant to be enforced. I wanted to ask you one more question, Stefan, about the WFA members' attitudes to consumer concern over privacy. So I wonder, in a way, like if people had time to sit and read through the language of the regulation, there are all these new transparency requirements. It's going to be really difficult to deliver on these transparency requirements, all this information disclosure to users. And we would say it's really a radical change in terms of how much information users are going to get. And I wonder if there is a feeling that perhaps that will allow, once it comes into force, will this start to cut the ground from under the paranoia or the real anxiety around data in our regulator community in Brussels? And I don't know if anyone's thinking about that, but I'd be interested to know if you.
I think there's a perception when you talk to brands that longer term, for our interaction with consumers to be sustainable, there needs to be a better understanding of what's going on. When you look at the data and when people are being polled in terms of what they think of the data collection practices and behavioral advertising, there's often you call it paranoia, sort of lingering concern that people just don't sufficiently understand what's happening and who's doing what. So I think, brand owners feel longer term, this is probably the right way, to be just more transparent in terms of what the terms of the exchange are. And I think what they're keen to do is find that right balance between meeting the legal obligations and making sure this is as seamless and as least disruptive as possible in the interface with consumers. And so we have actually set up a group called the Digital Governance Exchange, which is an interesting group where you get actually lawyers to sit with marketeers to actually test out and trial new ways of gathering consent, and which share very candidly their experiences. Because this is by no means easy thing to do. It's a very much an incremental trial and error thing. But it's actually a sort of best practice exchange group which helps learn from each other's experiences. And we've been hosting those meetings in Europe, but we're actually going to the US in New York on December 7th, precisely for that reason, in order to bring it actually closer to some of our US headquarters for them to understand what's in it. So it's going to be an incremental process, trial and error. And most importantly, it's not about writing the longest privacy policy. It's about making sure it's meaningful for consumers. Yeah.
So there's a little music. I guess we have time just for the quick call to arms. So the GDPR is a new regulation that's going to hit next May, but life will go on. Behind it is another proposal emanating from Brussels, which has been familiarly known as the Cookie Directive for a long time, and which I think we hoped they could just take off the table once this GDPR was adopted, put into place. So we wanted to take a couple minutes and alert everyone to the threat posed, we think, by the e-privacy proposal to digital advertising as we are currently practicing it. So 2 minutes on that, maybe a minute from each of you guys.
Okay, I think on e-privacy regulation, it's very important that we remember two things. Thing one, it is a lex specialis. That means it is actually a specific law of the GDPR, which actually covers the area electronic communication. So it has to be aligned with GDPR. The current text isn't, and therefore I think because it is still in the development phase, we really, really need to engage in a dialogue. The parliament is completely split. On the one hand side, they think we need to have accountability principle also built into the e-privacy regulation. The other party says, well, it's a fundamental human right. I am going to stick onto my opt-in. So the more we support the voice that actually calls for the concern, calls for balance, the better we are. Let us get more involved in our dialogue. This would be my message.
Okay. Yeah, I think the dialogue is key. I think just taking a step back for this audience to understand the difference between the GDPR and e-privacy. So the General Data Protection Regulation generally regulates the use of personal data. And as Sakiko was saying, the e-privacy directive, which is in place today, which is going to likely be updated by the regulation, is specific to electronic communications, and more specifically for a lot of folks in this room, is specific to the use of cookies and the use of device fingerprinting. And so the interplay between those is around consent. Under the General Data Protection Regulation, there are multiple bases that you can rely on to use personal data. With e-privacy, as drafted today, there is one basis, and it is consent, and it is a very, very strict interpretation of consent.
Absolutely.
And so what we're talking about and what Townie's talking about is this is still being worked on in Brussels, and we are all asked to continue to participate in that dialogue and make sure that all of our voices are heard around that.
Yeah, so this is something in which it's not too late yet, because the legal process isn't finished, but if you have any possibility to write to your local member of the European Parliament or contact your trade association and make a representation that just says, stop, let's let the GDPR settle and see in a year or two or five what else actually really needs to be done to protect consumers, that would be much appreciated by everyone who's in the trenches right now on it.
Thank Brilliant you. And famous last words, Tony. Thank you very much to our panel. I think you're all informed about GDPR now. There's no reason not to follow it. Thank you very much. Give them a hand again.
Thank you.